Hi, I'm Erinn Westbrook.
And I'm Avan Jogia, and this is Real Works.
Welcome to Real Works. Our show today looks at the secret life of teens. What are they thinking? How do they express their feelings? And what are they up to when no one is paying attention? Our first film by Zoe Spielman takes a look at the impact on her family after her father was diagnosed with cancer. Here's A Long Way to Go.
Hey.
Today is December
14th.
Yeah. Zoe's 9 months old as of December 3rd. Here she is. Can you get her?
Okay, Zoe. Okay, Zoe. Go for it.
Hey, sweetie.
Myelodysplastic syndrome, or MDS, is a disorder in which the bone marrow does not produce enough healthy blood cells. In patients with the condition, immature cells called blast cells make up more than 5% of the cells in the marrow. Normally, they make up less than 5%. The result is that the blast cells created do not develop into normal red cells, white cells, and platelets, and can lead to more serious health issues such as leukemia. In general, MDS is a disease of older adults. The treatment process for MDS involves several sessions of chemo and blood transfusions, ultimately leading up to a bone marrow transplant. Once the patient receives the transplant and returns home, they will not be up to their normal strength for at least a year. Researchers confirm that long-term survival is likely for MDS patients who survive at least 2 years after the transplantation.
When you first found out that you were diagnosed with MDS, what was your initial reaction?
It was kind of like, a little bit of denial, thinking MDS, what is MDS? They didn't say cancer, you know. And it took a couple of weeks before it really sunk in, you know, that, you know, this is a serious thing going on here.
Well, I think, you know, when you find out about, you know, if anyone has, like, serious illness or cancer, it's, you know, it's a lot of shock and like, kind of disbelief. In denial. I think I started, of course, right away to look at the internet about MDS, but I think I quickly stopped doing that because it became, you know, unbearable in its own way.
The way this MDS works, it's, you know, if you have a transplant, you know, it's curable. It's not like, you know, these people who are diagnosed with different tumors and stuff. And you know, there's a lot of hope for this.
My dad was diagnosed with MDS in August, right before the beginning of my senior year. Before I started working on this documentary, I didn't know what the process would be like, or that it was a form of cancer. But more importantly, I didn't realize how serious it was. I guess because of how well my dad was doing, I didn't think it was something too much to worry about. My dad's sister, Anne, was a perfect match for the bone marrow transplant, and the doctors were saying that the chemo was bringing up his blood counts and lessening the blast cells. Regardless, it was still something that had to be taken seriously. The hardest part of the entire process was during the last week of January, a few days after his transplant. I had the week off and my mom went back to work. It was probably the most difficult time for me during the entirety of my dad's illness. I spent the week going back and forth to the hospital. In addition, there was a bad snowstorm and my mom had not been feeling well either. It was difficult because there was so much to do. I felt lonely throughout all of it. Once my dad came home and I went back to school, it became somewhat easier. All the nervousness leading up to the transplant was gone. Still, there are difficult moments. I wish my mom could relax more and that my dad would feel better. There are times that I feel guilty because I think there are more things I could do for the both of them that I don't.
No, say the whole thing over.
You don't know the first thing about filmmaking, not like I do.
This is my sister Nora. She's been away at school. I asked her if it's been difficult being away while all of this has been happening.
Yeah, it was hard not really being able to totally know what was going on, because I'm just like not at the doctor's, or I'm not really around him. But it was like good and bad, because I was able to not worry about it when I'm at school, because I had a lot of work to do, but I also would worry about it because, I don't know, because I didn't know what else I should feel.
So now it's just adjusting. I think what we see on the other, in the websites about this, is like it's adjusting to a new normal. And that's, I think, what we've been doing, everybody. Yeah, I think it's just been a real ride, and we're still on it.
You know, my recommendation, anybody who has to go through it, don't be scared. We'll go through any of this. Don't be scared, and you know, deal with it, and it seems to go a lot better.
Looking back on the past few months, I realized that things will get easier eventually, but it takes a while. Regardless of all of this, I don't think I realize how fortunate I am. My dad's sister was a perfect match, and he was out of the hospital 17 days after his transplant. I know there are people who don't have a match for the bone marrow, or some that have to wait much longer than my dad did. MDS is serious, but there are far more serious cancers out there. The process was difficult, but I couldn't be more thankful for how everything turned out. I think I can speak for all of us in saying that.
A party which celebrates a young woman's coming of age in the Hispanic community. But for Liz's two close girlfriends, coming of age meant dealing with teen pregnancy and the tough decisions that go along with that. Here's Journey to the Unknown.
Recently, I turned 16. My family had a party for me. In Mexico, it's called la quinceañera, when a young girl comes of age. It was so much fun having a party and getting dressed up, and showing everybody I'm not a little girl anymore. But I have friends who have come of age in a different way.
What was your reaction when you found out you were pregnant?
Shock. I was paralyzed. I couldn't move, I couldn't breathe.
I was about to die. I was like nervous and, you know.
What's the relationship with the father?
The relationship with the father is bad. We don't even have a relationship.
Before I knew that I was pregnant, it was good. Now he don't wanna know nothing about the baby.
He was like, no, I don't want the baby. And he just started cursing at me. He started calling me all types of names, everything, and then he just walked away. That's the love of my life. I love this boy to death and everything, but he's a jerk. I hate him. He does not give me not even a dollar. If I have money, he asks me for money. He has money in his pocket and he still asks me for money. He doesn't give me nothing. He doesn't go with me to none of the appointments for nothing. Nothing. I don't even want to sit. I hate him.
Él cree que era mejor abortar que tener un hijo.
What do you think about girls having abortions or the guys making them have one?
I feel the girls should think about that upon themselves. If they feel it's right that they need to have an abortion, then that's them. I don't believe in abortions. I don't think that people should do it.
This is not my father. He's my stepfather. My mom says my real dad didn't want me. I don't even know who my real father is.
¿Cómo se llama tu papá?
Uh-huh. Se llama Celedonio Martínez. Si yo planeé detenerte a ti, no lo planeé.
So, ¿qué pasó?
¿Qué pasó para tenerte a ti? Un error de mi vida. El primer problema que hubo fue que tu padre es familiar.
¿Cómo qué?
Un tío.
¿De quién?
Por parte mía.
Yo, cuando te enteraste que estabas embarazada, ¿tú pensabas de abortar?
No.
¿Por qué?
Porque nunca había pensado en abortarte.
Life was a real struggle for me and my mom. We never had much money. And after me, she had two other children with two other fathers. Recently, she left my stepdad. Our lives are rough. I worry about my friends and the decisions they made to keep their kids.
I don't believe in abortions. I don't think that people should do it.
It's like you're killing somebody.
That's killing a child. I don't believe in killing the innocent.
Muy grande, eso, de tener a mi hijo, de saber que soy mamá, es una emoción muy grande que no se puede describir.
Marilyn did not have her baby. Her brother beat her up and she had a miscarriage.
He picked me up, he threw me in the hallway, and he just kept hitting me and hitting me. He just kept hitting me and like, he was crazy. My family got him off for me, but they already knew I was pregnant, but my mother didn't know. I'm like emotionally distracted. I'm a very, very emotional person. I would cry for the littlest things. So when I found out, I went crazy. I didn't want to come home. I didn't want to be nowhere. I just wanted to be alone. I just wanted to be outside, just away from my family, because I didn't want to be around my family at all.
After Marilyn lost her baby, she started sleeping with her boyfriend again without birth control. Having lived with the consequences of my mother having children as a teenager, I know that's a mistake I will never make.
Hi, it's Erinn Westbrook, and you guys just finished watching Journey to the Unknown by the very talented Liz Mejia. And I am lucky enough to be joined by her right now, and we're gonna talk about your film. Thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
Awesome film, by the way. This was very, I mean, I couldn't stop watching it. I almost wished it was a little bit longer. But I wanted to talk to you about how you sort of chose to explore the topic of the challenges of young and single moms. Why was that something that you wanted to make a film about?
Well, because my mother had me when she was a teenager. Mm-hmm. She, you know, raised, had me and my brother. And she was basically a single parent. And the struggles of her actually trying to raise us, starting at the age, you know, 17 when she had me. Mm-hmm. And then with my brother when she was 22. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like a, like, exploring. Mm-hmm. Kind of a way trying to understand that concept.
Right, so it was obviously a very personal film to you.
Yes.
A story that you've probably wanted to tell or at least delve into a little bit deeper for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Well, you did a really good job. And I especially enjoyed the parts where we did see you interviewing your mom, and the emotion that was there was obviously very real, and I think that the viewer could appreciate that. Now, you also were interviewing other girls in the film, other young teen moms, and yes. How did you find them? Because their stories were really remarkable, and I mean, it was difficult to watch at some points, hearing the challenges that they faced with their you know, the fathers of their children. How did you find these girls, and how did you get them to open up to you?
Well, actually, they were actually my classmates from school at the time.
Okay.
One of them, I think she was a year younger than me. Mm-hmm. I think she was like 14, and the other one was in my class. Mm-hmm. And I think at the time was the second time she got pregnant.
Wow.
First time she had an abortion, second time she decided to keep the child. Mm-hmm. But of course, in the film, you see she ended up having a miscarriage.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But yeah, there's like when I first was developing the story, it was like in the concept of my mother being a single parent, and it just so happens two of my friends, my classmates, are in the same predicament, in the same situation.
Right. So, and they were okay. Obviously, it seemed like they were pretty okay with sharing their stories with you.
Marilyn was.
Yes.
She was more comfortable sharing the story. Yasmin, kind of like, I don't know.
Cautious. But, I mean, they were great additions to the story and to the film. So I'm glad that they did ultimately both open up to you in the ways that they did. And we hope to see more from you. Do you have any plans to do anything else in the future?
No, hopefully sometime, whenever.
Yeah.
I'm able to rally some people up and probably
cool
shoot
to,
something.
It'd be cool to do follow-up with some of the girls and maybe track down, you know, the one that you lost touch with. I think the audience might find that pretty exciting to see what's up with them.
That wouldn't be a bad idea.
Not a bad
idea.
Well, thanks again for chatting with us. And thank you guys for tuning in.
Hey, don't you remember? They called me Al, it was Al all the time. Say, don't you remember, I'm your pal. Buddy, can you spare a dime?
This is my doll. Her name is Laurita. When I immigrated, when we came from DR, she, the bunny, and another lamp I used to have, but I just recently threw it out, were like the only things I had. And I used to cry a lot, so this is a messed up thing about this bunny. I got her since I was really young. If you go like this, in the bottom of the bunny, you get bunny babies. You get two, you get the three, Larry and Curly. My Little Pony. You have Discord, Dark Derpy, and over here you have a giant Dr. Hooves and a giant Fluttershy. I have a problem with books. I would call it a healthy obsession that, like, I'm not gonna give my books to anyone. And yeah, this is my desk, and I keep a lot of papers. Oh my gosh, here it is. I didn't know I had this. This is a picture of me and my dad.
Thank you.
here I have a script that talks about my imagination in general, my childhood, how probably being a kid is very nice because as a kid you never really notice that your parents don't hang out together or that they hate each other's guts, naivety, and all that stuff. So, imagination made me, like, not be here because I was, like, I used to get so upset. I remember I had this point in my life where I was writing stories and I was so deep into it I would believe I was in the story, and then when I like woke up and I realized I was not in the story, I would just feel really depressed. It was terrible. I would just be really upset because I was here and not in there.
Siompa. Bueno, acabo de llegar de una clase de video y nos llamé para ver si usted quería salir el día de los padres.
¿Qué día es? ¿Qué día es?
El día de los padres cae domingo.
¿El domingo o el otro?
El 21, papi.
¿Tú sabes tú lo que tú quieres ahora? ¿Tú no sabes lo que tú quieres?
Bueno, yo sé que lo mío es la escritura.
Aunque sea la escritura. Eso decía Milena también. Okay. Tú no puedes saber lo que tú vas a escoger hasta que tú no tengas profesión.
Yo entiendo, papi, pero Milena es Milena y Carol es Carol.
Sí, pero la cosa no se acelera. Todo en la vida llega solo. Todo.
Nadie, no venimos con un manual de cómo ser padres, o sea que como esa persona en ese momento entienda que está haciendo, debemos aceptar eso sin buscarle más allá, porque no somos quien para juzgar a nadie.
Hey Dad, did you know my fave place to shop is Hot Topic, and then I like dressing all in black, except some days which I randomly dress all in pink. And did you know that I also like My Little Pony while listening to rock hardcore screamo and dressing all in black while Sundays dressing all in pink? And I guess it's fair to say that I didn't know you write music and you have a really good singing voice and that you really want to learn to play the guitar. Yeah, we don't know some things about each other, so why don't you say, like, we just get together one day and we just sit down and talk it through, maybe over a cup of coffee. You know, if you think I'm old enough to drink coffee. So, yeah.
Papa.
Hi, I'm Carol Matos. The name of my film is My Missing Stuff.
It was Al all the time.
At first, my film was going to be black and white, and it was gonna only have title cards. It was gonna be Charlie Chaplin style. When I started working on it, I realized I have to make the story deeper than that. So then I was like, okay, I can tell this story, I can make it more interesting, but then it's like, how do I make this without, like, basically putting blame on people? It's kind of about, also it's about my relationship with my dad, but it's about kind of me maintaining my childhood in a way, because I'm kind of childish. Then my friend just drew these characters for me and I drew the scenes and it was like, okay, let's try this out to see if it works. I decided to use really like old-timey music because like back when I was in sixth grade, I had like my first male teacher. Nearly all of my teachers had been female. We were in Catholic school. And one day he walks in like with this huge album and it's full of these huge discs. He's like, hey guys, check this out. And he gets a Victrola and then he plays it. And the song is Brother, Can You Spare a Dime by Bing Crosby. And I heard his voice and I was like, oh my gosh, it's amazing. And the teacher's like, yeah, you can listen to it on other things, but it sounds deep when it's on the Victrola because it was better recorded to sound like that.
I'm your pal, buddy, can you spare a dime?
Thanks for joining us.
Tune in next time for Real Works.